We have three pairs of major salivary glands, parotid glands, submandibular glands, and sublingual glands. In this model, we're looking at the left major salivary glands. However, we have about 800 to 1,000 minor salivary glands that we find them in different parts of the oral mucosa. For example, in labial mucosa, buccal mucosa, lingual mucosa, the mucosa that covers the tongue, also in palatal mucosa. But please keep in mind, when we say palatal mucosa contains minor salivary glands, we mean the mucosa that covers the soft palate. In hard palate, we do not find minor salivary glands. And also at the base of the circumvallate papillae that we have in tongue, we can find some minor salivary glands that specifically we refer to them as von Ebner's glands. So we have plenty of minor salivary glands, but in this video, mostly we focus on the major salivary glands, and I would like to start with the largest major salivary gland, which is parotid gland. As you see, parotid gland sits in front of the ear. It's located exactly between skin and this strong muscle, masseter, and parotid gland is the largest salivary gland that we have. However, it just produces about 25% of the total volume of saliva that is secreted in a day. Each parotid gland has a duct. As you see, the duct moves anteriorly, superficial to masseter muscle, and then it's superficial to buccinator muscle. And at some point, it has to pierce the buccinator muscle and open into the buccal mucosa exactly opposite the maxillary second molar. So if you check your own buccal mucosa exactly opposite to your second maxillary molar, you should feel a tiny elevation that is called parotid papilla. That's exactly where parotid duct opens to. Please keep in mind that the other name for parotid duct is Stensen's duct. When we analyze the saliva that parotid glands secrete, we see that the type of saliva that they secrete is watery. We call that serous type of saliva. And please keep in mind that in the facial region, the sensation from these structures will be transferred to the brain through different branches of trigeminal nerves, cranial nerves number 5. However, to stimulate secretion of saliva from the salivary glands, we have to use motor axons of some other cranial nerves. For example, the parasympathetic axons that we find in glossopharyngeal nerves, cranial nerves number 9, are the ones that stimulate secretion from parotid salivary glands. We can palpate parotid salivary glands in an extraoral examination. What we do, we start in front of the ear, and then we move toward the zygomatic arch, which is supposed to be here. And then from there, we move down toward the angle of the mandible. So that would be the way that we palpate parotid gland. The next major salivary gland would be submandibular salivary gland. It has a superficial and also a deep lobe. And as you can see, submandibular salivary gland sits medial to the body of mandible. Obviously here, we remove the body of mandible to see the submandibular salivary gland, and part of it sits a little bit below the inferior border of the body of mandible. Also, this gland could be palpated and examined extraorally. And submandibular glands, even though they're not the largest major salivary glands, produce 60 to 65% of the total volume of saliva. From each submandibular gland, we get a long duct. We call it either submandibular duct or Wharton's duct. And when we follow this duct, we see that it runs through the mouth floor, the floor of the mouth, lateral to the midline, and exactly behind the mandibular incisors, it opens into the mouth floor. So that would be exactly where the submandibular salivary glands secrete their saliva. And when we analyze the saliva that submandibular glands secrete, we see that the saliva is a mix of watery, serous, and thick, viscous, mucus type of saliva. The parasympathetic nerves that stimulate secretion of saliva from submandibular glands are found in some of the branches of facial nerves, cranial nerves number 7. Then we move on to sublingual glands. They're located exactly below the tongue. And sublingual glands also are stimulated by parasympathetic axons of the facial nerves. As you can see, each sublingual gland has several of these short ducts. In each one of these sublingual glands, we can find 8 to 20 of these short ducts that they all open to the mouth floor. However, some of these ducts join together and form a duct that is called Bartholin's duct, and that duct opens exactly in the same place that the duct of submandibular gland opens. So we can say in mouth floor, behind the mandibular incisors, we get secretion from both submandibular glands and also sublingual glands. When we analyze the secretion of saliva from sublingual glands, we notice that they also have a mixed secretion, mix of serous and mucus. However, the mucus part is more prominent. So in short, we can say that sublingual glands secrete a thicker type of mucus than submandibular glands. The next thing is that we have to notice that secretion of saliva into oral cavity helps in many different aspects. For example, we use saliva to make food moist and eventually turn it into a soft, flexible mass called bolus to swallow it easily. Also, we know that saliva has a cleansing aspect to it. Basically, it cleans the inside of the mouth and we swallow saliva afterward. Also, sometimes we eliminate saliva by coughing, sneezing, spitting, and so on. In saliva, we can find a very large amount of water. In general, 99.5% of saliva is water and only 0.5% is solute. And one of those solutes that we find in saliva would be some buffers that they actually a little bit help neutralizing the pH. However, please note that the pH of saliva is slightly acidic in general. And also, one other solute that we find in saliva would be the enzyme lysozyme. Recall, one of the things that lysozyme can do would be breaking down the wall of some bacteria and causing the cytolysis of those bacteria. In saliva, we also find immunoglobulin A. Recall, immunoglobulin A, that makes it very difficult for microorganisms to attach to our cells and invade our cells. So we can say that saliva, aside from cleaning the inside of the mouth and moistening the food, it also has a role in immunity. Both parotid glands and submandibular glands could be palpated extraorally. However, when it comes to palpation of the sublingual glands, we can palpate them intraorally. Basically, we have to go under the tongue and then on both sides, lateral to the midline, palpate the sublingual glands that we have in the area.